Tell us a little bit about the game for those who haven't played before. All of you or any of you.
Okay, this is the fifth in the series of games, and the game is a horror game in which you kind of make your way through this thing where there are haunted animatronics a la Chuck E. Cheese, one of the creepiest places on Earth. You remember the robotic dancing animals that gave everybody nightmares. So going through this pizza place, you go through and try to avoid being jump scared and killed by these animals. In our game, the first game with voice acting of any degree, it's the first game where you move through the pizza joint as the night maintenance man to maintain these. You have to work on these animals that want to kill you.
Yeah.
And it's great fun. So these three play haunted animals that want to kill you, and I'm the only friendly voice in the game, probably.
They're actually kind of more like women than animals. It's funny, in this installment, this was the first one where he introduced, usually they're like anthropomorphic animals, but this one, Ballora is a ballerina who, you know, at least looks human, and Baby is a...
clown.
A baby dog.
We love Baby.
An animatronic clown, so let's take it up a notch on the creepiness.
Yeah.
And also, mad props to you for using the word anthropomorphic.
I have a thesaurus.
I used to be a teacher. All
right, the floor is open for questions.
You look amazing. That's all.
Aguilar? No, Aguilar's the new one.
All right.
Ezio.
So, it's the horror genre, of course. Do you guys have any favorite horror genre games that you guys play or did play growing up at all?
Other than the one we were in, yeah.
Yeah.
I really liked Adam Wake, the one with the camera, and it came packaged with my Xbox 360 back in the day, and I really grew to like it. Also, I just want to say Alan Wake, not Adam Wake. I'm barely awake.
He's really tired.
Yeah. It sounded right to me.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Alan Wake is the...
Well, I'm a child of the 80s, and then in the 90s, I focused most of my time on alcohol, but it was...
Which is college. A horror story.
So, you know, I'm like, what did I play that was scary? Castlevania? You know, so there was the ghosts on Super Mario Brothers. So I really... Yeah. So, no, and I think Michelle...
It's an oldie.
Well, Heather warned me against playing horror games, so I just never went there. Thank you, Heather.
So, personally, being a part of something that's horror, what is it that you think really defines horror? What is it that makes it the horror genre so magnificent, I guess?
Well, can I? Okay, well, I can talk about this one in particular, because Scott Cawthon, the creator of this game, this isn't a slasher game. There's almost no blood. There's nothing really... demonic, you know, the sixth sense or anything about it. He really just is capitalized on the stuff that really, really, really scares us. Like, well, the jump scares, of course, are all based on the fact that you're deep in concentration when they happen. You know, it's never just a boo. It's always like, okay, I've got to really focus on this. And then it's a boo.
Yeah.
But the little things of the uncertainty, the idea that you're not safe, even... there's a scene where you're under the desk and you've pulled a piece of sheet metal in front of you, and then the bad guys start to move the sheet metal. Imagine having your sheet over your head at night as a kid and then the sheet being lifted. That's the feeling of that. And so he's got that whole, he's really been able to articulate what really frightens us. And it's not the devil and witches and Jason from Friday the 13th. It's really... that
speak
uncertainty and not, well, those are scary, but the unsafeness and the uncertainty, the suspense of it all. Yeah, he's really good at it.
Yeah, you described it good. I can't do it any better than that.
I guess, what are your biggest fears then? What are you guys most afraid of?
Oh, what's under the bed?
I'm afraid to say, because then if somebody sees this, they're going to send a jar of bees to my house, because I have apophobia. I'm terribly afraid of bees.
Oh, that's so interesting. Yeah. Usually it's spiders and stuff like that.
If there's something like small and can sting you and like easily angry and it's like buzzing around you and you can't get it away, and that's scary to me.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I have claustrophobia, and I constantly try to like overcome it, right? Like, and so a couple years ago, they had this hay maze where at some carnival, Halloween carnival or whatever, and they make this massive hay maze, and it has different levels and everything, but you crawl through the whole thing. And so to conquer my fear, I was like, you know, I can do this because I'm a grown up. And my kids wanted to go through it. And when you got kids, you know, you got to man up for your kids, right? So I started to go through it, and the whole time I had to like talk myself through it, and unfortunately I made a real big fool of myself because I started like chanting things very loudly and screaming and singing childhood songs like I don't even remember Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, like screaming, not very adult. My daughter was there. It was very humiliating. And meanwhile there are little like 6-year-olds like going through it, having so much fun. It was horrifying. I will never do it again, and still to this day talking about it, I'm like horrifying. So some fears, they're just there, man.
I was really struggling to come up with something I was scared of, and then Heather reminded me I am a bit claustrophobic, and that may be it, but not so much the mazes and stuff. I really only have my arms pinned. And there's a scene in the Five Nights at Freddy's book where one of the kids has been taken prisoner, and he's in one of the animatronic suits, but they've pinned his arms in it. And that's maybe the scariest part of the book for me, the slashing and the animals chasing you.
But the being confined.
I don't like having my arms pinned.
I misrepresented that. The hay maze, the hay was all around you and on top of you. Oh, it wasn't like a walk-through maze. It was like a tunnel.
Oh, no.
Walk-through, at least you can touch the air.
I'm okay with that, I guess.
Yeah. Anyway.
But if people, like in my life, people like dogpile you. You find out your birthday and all the guys jump on you and you're at the bottom of the pile and all that. I just got to bring my brain to another place. Go, it's okay. It's going to be over in a minute. It's going to be, you just breathe deep, breathe normally, and it's, claustrophobia. That's it, though.
Yeah, claustrophobia.
I'm good with heights. I'm good with animals,
claustrophobia,
snakes, whatever.
For sure.
Yeah.
Heather and I, because I think we live not in the city.
Yes.
In the country. Today or yesterday, I was in the elevator, and so were about 20 other people, and I was stuck in the corner, and I'm like, Heather, please don't take your eyes off me. I'm having a panic attack.
It's okay, Michella. We're almost there.
Really scary. And
I'm just scared of bees
rooms
over
without
here.
Windows.
Helps to fart when you get
rooms
a
without
like
windows.
The way you just.
I hope this isn't material to mail in the fear factor or anything, because that'd be me.
You're the only one that's got something somebody could.
I mean, if somebody dumped a bunch of hay on you, you wouldn't be too happy. Like just randomly outside the door.
I have a bucket of hay. Here you go. What are some projects that you guys are looking forward to in the future, either as a group or individually?
You mean that we're working on?
Or that you could be going on, working on in the future, yeah. So either individually or as a group.
That we're allowed to talk
about. I was going
to
say.
Well, I'm in a video game coming out this year called Nilo. I'm pretty excited. I think it's coming out in August, and it looks like it's going to be really awesome. It's kind of a science fiction, fast-paced shooter.
Okay.
With a little, the scenes in between are where all the voice actors are, but it looks pretty awesome.
All right. Anyone else working on anything interesting?
N-E-L-O for the press members out there.
How do you spell it, N-E-L-O?
N-E-L-O, Nilo. Lead is played by Todd Haberkorn.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Cool. He calls his house the Habertat.
Yes.
I love him. There's a lot of stuff we can't talk about because of NDAs and stuff, but there's one that got announced at EA last year called Faye that I'm working on, and it's all creature noises and...
Do a creature noise.
Go ahead.
He's really good at creature noises.
Ladies and gentlemen, Kellen Goff.
That was pretty awesome.
I know.
Yeah, but that's coming out hopefully later this year, if not early next year. And it's very atmospheric, and guys at Zoink in Sweden are working very hard on it. So I'm really excited for that.
Awesome.
Michelle?
Anyway.
No, it's fine.
I'm actually working on a meditation series this summer that I'm really looking forward to. That's my most favorite thing that I'm going to be doing because it's so chill and it's summer.
I have a couple of projects that are coming up that I also can't talk about, but I'm excited about. I just completed a little while ago a project that I really fell in love with, and that was the game where I got to voice there like 20 different characters. How fun is that, right? When you get to be not just one character, but you get to be all kinds of. So it's a game called Eternal, and it's kind of like Hearthstone, except they're wanting it to be better. It's in its beta right now.
She glares at me because I'm in Hearthstone.
He's in Hearthstone. but it's the art for it. The art on the cards is amazingly fantastic. Mm. And so that's really cool.
Didn't you say you got beaten in it the other day by your own cards? You got to listen to yourself.
It's also
talk
a game
smack
that I'm actually addicted to because because it's really fun and really smart. And that is the lame thing about voicing it is that when you're playing against an opponent and they play my card and beat me with my card, so it's my character mocking me as I'm defeated. It's my own voice. Like, that's not
that's
right,
really awesome.
Yo.
That's self-hate,
that right?
Dude.
I know, that's not right.
That's self-deprecation.
So I would actually love to get involved with more projects like that where you can kind of, you know, run the gamut of all kinds of different characters. So
awesome. Questions?
Andy Barnett's in that, right?
Yeah.
I've been talking with him about getting
it. College Radio. Danny.
Hi, Danny.
Do you have any inspirational stuff that you can give to any inspiring students going into voice acting?
Take acting classes, because voice acting, people like say, oh, you could get into voice acting, you have a cool voice, but that's just one aspect of it. The major aspect is you have to learn how to act before you can act without an audience, because it's so much harder to gauge if you're being funny or impactful or not without somebody telling you yes or no. And the director, most of the time, they're going to be behind this glass wall that's like completely silent, and you're going to be in there with a bunch of self-doubt and stuff. So you need to build that confidence first and that acting repertoire before you tackle voice acting, I think.
And I'll say, if you're in a community college and they don't have a drama program, take the speech classes.
Yeah,
they all have
yeah.
that, and that was a really big influencer in my thing. Just learn how to say things so they sound like you're really saying them.
Yeah.
And you know, the vocal warm-ups and the project yourself and the having to stand up in front of people and talk, the confidence and stuff.
The lip trills and
yeah,
all that.
Yeah, speech. Amidst the mists and coldest frosts and stoutest wrists and proudest boasts.
Yeah.
He thrusts his
like
fist
that.
Against the post.
Oh,
he still insists he's
PG-13.
All that was in my my speech class at LSU in 1989.
Oh my.
Still remember it. It's a big deal, speech.
Yeah.
Speech. I would also say get involved in Facebook groups and forums online that have voice actors in them. One thing that I have been really, really amazed with, because I'm from Alaska, yo, so I'm far away.
Yo,
and so all of my stuff that I have gotten into this business has been me learning everything on my own, not the acting part. I received training for that. But as far as like getting into the community and finding out how to go about things, came about from finding people who already knew what they were doing and asking questions of them. And what amazed me the most is that there are voice actors who are big names. Bob Bergen is an amazing voice actor who you studied with, right?
Porky Pig.
I did study with him. I was the first ever minor in his class at 14. So, Bob Bergen,
yeah.
Porky Pig,
yeah.
great guy to study
great
with.
Great guy.
Yeah.
Big guy. Like, seriously huge in the industry. And this is a guy who nobody's ask him questions all the time on Facebook, and he will answer you and help you and offer you fantastic advice. Brilliant. So it's amazing. So get involved in voice.
D. Bradley Baker has a how to get started in voiceover guide online.
Yeah.
I want to be a voice actor.com.
Yeah.
Perfect resource for this kind of stuff.
Yep.
Awesome. I think we have time for one more question.
Purple guy. Seriously. No, we have a character in the game called Purple Guy.
Yeah,
okay.
I was curious what your non-voicing voice acting work has done to affect your voice acting work, since we've all done an infinite amount of jobs collectively.
Will you say that one more time? I didn't.
How has your non-voice acting work affected your voice acting work? Has it inspired certain aspects in any way?
It's probably not the answer you're looking for, but in film ADR, they're like the stuff they do in post, right? After everything is done and the mics didn't pick up the crowds or whatever, so they get in a bunch of voice actors to voice the crowds behind all the action that's going on in the Avengers or whatever. So having knowledge about... Like I had some knowledge about police code and some karate knowledge as I took some courses
nice.
In that. And so having some knowledge from like real life experiences can factor into that, because that would make you a special candidate for if there was a karate movie or whatever. Not a lot of people can bring the terms to mind, and it's a lot of improv in there, not a lot of scripted stuff in film ADR. So that's probably not the answer you were looking for, but that's the first thing that came to mind.
Well, and he's been doing this since he was a kid, so he doesn't have much like non-voice acting work, so that's like the best he has to go on.
I was a busboy.
Were you?
Once.
I've never heard of any actors being busboys. That's such a unique career.
Oh, okay, Miss Alaska, fine. I just won't talk anymore, huh?
We love you. I would say I'm not much better, because I have a theater degree and was a theater teacher, so it's not like my world is that much better. I don't have very much grown-up experience either.
We're a couple of bozos.
But I would say non-voice. Oh, I had something. Never mind. I had something in the
teaching.
Teaching.
Yeah.
Youngest mid-30s. No, that wasn't it. Okay. I don't remember. Here, go on.
I've been a musician for years and years, and a singer. So that gave me a lot of experience, just knowing the capability of my voice and being familiar with the microphone and music editing and.
That helped you land the role, right?
It did, actually, yeah. I had to write a song for Ballora's character, and that probably is what got me the role, yes.
So there you go.
Certainly a haunting melody. I've done a lot of stuff. I was a musician. I sang a little bit in a band and stuff.
No kidding.
Like that. Well, I was the drummer, but we lost a singer, and I ended up singing like 20 of our songs, but I wasn't the main singer.
So you're Phil Collins.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Well, I like the guy from the Romantics, except he plays left-handed. Anyway, but my biggest jobs, 2 months ago, I had 3 jobs, including voice acting. I was a teacher. I'm still in the Army Reserve. I've been in the Army Reserve 28 years. And I would say teaching helps, because you know how to communicate to people. So when you're reading a script, it really helps know how the sentence is supposed to go. What did the author of that script want? What was he really trying to convey? And then you know how to accent a certain word.
Sure.
But the soldier thing, 28 years in the Army, I've become a student of culture. I mean, I've had a lot of public speaking opportunities in the Army. I'm always the MC in every unit I've ever been in. You know, I got to sit next to Bart Starr, the MVP of Super Bowl I and II. He was the guest speaker one time. And the 2 national championships before that, before we had Super Bowls. But anyway, so I've done a lot of MCing, and you know, if you're marching places, I was always, as a young man, the guy that was calling all those cadences and all that. But really the cultural experience from the Army, not just of going to Afghanistan and Iraq and Kuwait and all these great countries, but the Americans that you meet, because the Army is such a hodgepodge of everyone. I mean, you'll have a Puerto Rican right next to old redneck from Mississippi, right next to a guy that used to be a gangbanger in Chicago, right next to a guy from Boston, and they're all on the same team.
So how many accents can you do?
I can do some accents, but really it's the whole cultural thing of just everybody has different values and different things that are important to them. And so when you get that spec for a script that says 31-year-old guy from such and such place, and he thinks this is important, I've met that guy. And it's because that's you cool. Just go from place to place to place, and you.
I imagine it gives you more to draw from as well.
It really does. I've got a bank of characters, you know, like, well, we want this guy, and I say, oh, that was my drill sergeant in 1989. I'm gonna be that guy. Hot damn it! When I was in Korea, you know, yeah. That's how we talk. He said, hot damn it. That was his. He said, hot damn it, all the time.
Hot damn it.
Hot damn it. You guys are a bunch of sissies. When I was in Korea, we'd have peed in our pants before we asked to go to the bathroom. You know, and it was just, you know.
Our early Ermy was actually just a drill sergeant before he took the role in Full Metal Jacket.
Oh, yeah, right? He was.
Straight up.
He was straight legit.
He actually punched one of the actors.
Yeah, he
in the
punched
gut.
Matthew McConaughey in the stomach.
Yeah. Yeah.
Legit. It was McConaughey, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no, Modine.
Sorry, that's all the time we have.
Okay.
You sure?
Yeah, that is. Thank you so much for coming, guys.
Thanks,
Kellen,
guys.
Andy, Heather, and Michella.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming in today. Yes.
Thank you for having us.